commercial hillbilly music began in a small way in towns like this, Morgantown, Kentucky, where the folk musicians brought their instruments to town to play in the courthouse square on Saturday. The idea that folk music is solely the possession of and product of domestic tradition, the spinners and knitters in the sun, is essentially a romantic concept and an outmoded concept. Folk cultures produce professional tale tellers and professional musicians. They exist in many parts of the world today. And minstrels of a sort had much to do with the development of hillbilly music. Hillbilly music is instrumentally influenced, if not instrumentally dominated. The fiddle and perhaps the dulcimer were about the only instruments available to the white folk musicians in the early 19th century. After the turn of the century, the banjo and the guitar and the mandolin were in the possession of folk musicians in the South and were regularizing the rhythm of folk song, altering its modal and chordal structure, and developing small string bands. The South and even the Southern Appalachians were not totally isolated from developments in American culture. Folk musicians accepted and altered selectively the foreign materials. The outside music affected domestic tradition, but especially what we may call the professional tradition. There were local musicians playing for neighborhood socials, itinerant street minstrels with old and new songs selling broadsides or ballads. There were medicine shows and circuses that used these folk performers whose music was hillbilly music. These entertainers formed the basis of hillbilly music on radio and phonograph records. One of the earliest of these musicians was and is Clarence Tom Ashley. Well, Clarence,
how do you do, sir?
How do you do?
Just fine, thank you.
Can you tell me when you first began to play your music?
Well, I've been playing and trying to play ever since I was quite a small boy.
When was that?
Well, that was, I was possibly 10 years of age, and I was born in 1895. Oh, I was about 15 when I took off at the first old medicine show come through. And, you know, I was always crazy about the show business. And every show would come through, I'd get me up a bunch of boys and put me on the show. If it was a circus, I'd perform. And if it was music, I'd do the same. And I was always crazy about the show business. And an old gentleman come through at the medicine show and wanted to hire me, and I started in with him, and of course he taught me a lot of things that I didn't know, and from there I went on, you know.
When did they start making records of this kind of music?
Well, that was summers in the 20s, I'd say, best I could remember.
That's when you started making records in
that's
the 20s?
That's right. Soon after Al Hopkins and the boys called themselves hillbillies. I guess that started the name of hillbilly music. Yeah. Was Al Hopkins and his brothers. They was on the way to New York, and their father lived in Washington while they were still presiding in North Carolina, in the western part of North Carolina. So they stopped over to stay all night with their father, and he was quite a good, big man in Washington. He was a doctor, and Al told him they was going to New York to make records. And he said, now what can you hillbillies do in New York? After they went on to New York, left Washington, went on to New York, they did do some records for the Columbia, I think it was. Or anyhow, Mr. Frank Walker, I think, was the recording manager. And they taken the name Hillbillies. And they called themselves Al Hopkins and his Hillbillies.
Well, Clarence, when they were making these records in New York, and when you were making records there, how much did these people that were making the records know about this kind of music?
How much did they know about it?
That's right.
Not anything.
Well, how'd they know what to record?
Well, they was just looking for something and hoping they'd find it. In other words, they wasn't musicians, and they didn't have the talent, and they didn't have the feeling. And they wouldn't know whether you was in tune or whether you was out of tune.
Well, when you told Frank Walker you'd play molassy-making tune, what was the tune you played?
I very, very well remember that. He set his glasses down on his nose, and he says, I want to hear one of them. I never hear a lassy-making tune. Well, I said, give me the banjo. They handed me the banjo, some of them did, and I tuned it up in this minor key, you see?
What do you call that key?
Lassie-making tune. Sawmill key.
Sawmill key. Huh?
Sawmill key. And this is what I played for him.
That was great, Clarence. What did Frank Walker say then?
Frank set his glasses down on his nose about like that. He says, how many of them can you have me by 2 o'clock tomorrow? I says, just as many as you want, I'm loaded with them.
Clarence had plenty of them, and so did many of the other boys.